So I don't know if this is the worst movie we've ever watched, but I certainly hated it.
Yeah.
I hate it. It's bad.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe you guys haven't seen that other Fantastic Four movie?
No, we have, and it's better, actually. So
I can't. No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
No.
Are you talking about the Roger Corman one or the Fan Four stick?
I'm talking about the Josh Trank stick.
Okay.
I respect Fan Four stick more because there was something buried in there that someone was legitimately trying to do. Like they were kind of at least trying to reinvent the wheel. And then got their hands slapped.
But they got a square.
No, yeah, I've always said that the first hour of that movie is fine. It's like it's a fine movie and it's building towards a certain thing. And then that movie goes off the road and into a lake. And then that lake is set on fire.
And then... No, everything you're saying is more interesting than the second half of that movie.
Yeah.
But to go back to Arlen's analogy... That works because this version of Fantastic Four was on fire the minute they started talking about it. Everything was burning. There was the smell of burning condoms and death in the air the minute this film was even a thought in someone's idea in mind.
I thought this came out in like the year 2000, 2001. I thought it was a lot older than it was.
Yep.
And then I saw it came out in 2005. I was like, oh, this must have been one of the death knells of 2000's bad superhero movies.
You would think. Yeah. But then...
This came out like a month after Batman Begins.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. What?
Yeah.
Yes.
Holy shit, Batman Begins is that old?
Oh, yeah.
I can actually, I have it pulled up. I can tell you what came out on. So this came out July 8th weekend. Charlie and the Chocolate Factory and Wedding Crashers was the next weekend.
Oh, God.
And right before it, the next big movie was War of the Worlds. Came out two weekends before.
Wow.
Whoa.
Weird year.
And Batman Begins came out like about a month before it.
Holy shit.
Yeah, it's kind of funny to have like the example of like, hey, this idea and how we treat this is growing. We're understanding it. Right before, look, we still don't get it.
Yeah,
episode 3 came out 2 months before it.
I actually that makes sense.
Sin City came out that April, and this was in June. This was in June, July.
Is Sin City though? You can't really compare comic wise. Yeah, like that's kind of an anomaly.
Also, that was a movie for sweaty nerds. If I'm gonna be honest.
I like Sin City.
I enjoy it too.
I'm not making any judgment of the film. I'm just saying, as a kid, I knew no kids who were excited about Sin City.
Oh, you're talking about, it's not like you look at it and be like, that's a comic book movie.
No.
Like, that was for who were like,
but, yeah, but I really
I wasn't a kid. This was my senior year of high school.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I was in fifth grade.
I was in high school, but I think I was
24. I was in fifth? Grade as well. I was in fifth grade in 05.
But Connor, this did come out several months before one of your movie dumpster movies.
Which one?
Venom.
I was about to say Venom.
Holy shit, that movie is a fucking abomination. And that movie is definitely worse than Fantastic Four.
I mean,
that's a good. At least I got that.
No, is this one of the worst movies I've ever seen? No. But is it inexcusably bad? Sure is.
We're going through the canon of our movies, though, that we've reviewed, I think this is there with, for me personally, Spawn. Connor, is this there for you with Daredevil? Because I know that's the one that you hate the most.
Daredevil's worse, but it's like it's in the same neighborhood.
I would say Daredevil's way worse.
Daredevil is way worse.
They suffer from the same problems, though.
This and Spawn are watchable if it's on cable and you have nothing to do.
That's how I watch Silver Surfer.
Yeah, we have TV, very different definitions of watchable.
And this is as watchable as like a golf tournament. Background noise.
So are you not watchable forgetting at all. About? Are you gentlemen forgetting about Ghost Rider?
Ghost Rider is fun.
Ghost Rider is in between.
You have a very warped definition of fun, then.
No, you know what I mean, though. Like, it's
fun. It's fun to watch Nicolas Cage be Nicolas Cage.
Yeah.
Well, can I ask you an existential question? Who is portrayed worse, Eva Mendes or Jessica Alba?
Jessica Alba.
Jessica Alba.
At least they're not making Eva Mendes dye her hair. Like, that's...
And,
oh, no. You missed. She put in... They had to put in contacts to make her eyes blue. That's worse than hair dye.
No, I know. But you know what I mean. It's a symptom of a larger problem that I have with their use of her in this movie.
And Eva Mendes's character at least seemed competent at her job.
Yeah.
She was hot girl reporter.
Yeah.
And she still at least had a job that she was doing. And she what was Sue's most scientific position in this entire movie?
Yes.
She pressed a button once.
I was going to say she was looking at Reed through that magnifying glass.
Yeah, she's observing.
Like, every time Reed is shown at a console, it's just like, I'm doing the science thing. Like, I don't know what the fuck he's doing anytime he's sitting down.
This movie has no idea what science is. Like, I don't know.
My biggest defense as the one person who thinks this is better than everybody else is that I think the casting besides Alba is not bad.
Here's the thing. Ben Grimm is easily my favorite thing about this movie.
Michael Chiklis. On this, is
he
that...
is like he's so Ben Grimm that I think of in the comics.
Okay, so this is my sort of defense of what Lou was just saying. While I agree, it would be better if they were all in the same film, which is something that I'm going to throw this out here now. None of these people are in the same movie. the person
everyone is doing a performance that doesn't complement the other one.
Doom is in a different movie than Ian Gruffudd. He's in a completely different movie than Jessica Alba.
Doom is a James Bond movie.
Yes. Michael Chiklis is in like a soft drama about somebody going through like a disease or something. Chris Evans, I don't know what movie he's in, but I want to go to that movie. That movie sounds fun.
He is in Not Another Teen Movie.
Yes.
He's in Extreme Dude 2005.
No, he's just in a Tim Story movie. He's just like the only character that feels like this director's usual characters.
Mm-hmm.
But I do love him and Ben together. I feel like they're fun, and they're like what I think of when I think of Human Torch and The Thing.
I see, that was my thing. I felt like the one scene where they showed them like doing their typical maneuvers from the comics, where like Johnny's playing tricks on and whatnot, felt super forced, because it was during that ridiculous montage scene where you see where you see Reed doing the science and you see Sue, I don't know, learning how to button up a shirt properly.
This wasn't when she was running away naked from crowds of people.
Which time was that? Because I lost track.
Which time was that? Exactly.
Although we did get two scenes of two male characters fully naked, and we did not see any dong.
That is true.
Exactly.
That is very true.
My wife and I watched this movie together, which I apologize to her for that. And I had pointed out when at the very end of the movie, why did we not see any even hint of Doom's penis? Which made me realize maybe that's why he was so angry. It's just because dude wanted to take a leak, and was sealed over in metal.
Not even not full frontal. It was like zoomed in on his crotch.
Yeah.
It was that full frontal.
You don't see any dick at all.
No. And if we're gonna see that much of Jessica Alba's cleavage, the least we could do is see a little bit of dangling, like just a little bit of dick neck, maybe a little bit of underball.
Yeah.
But then they would lose that PG. I'm guessing, was this PG or PG-13?
PG-13. No, there,
really?
In no universe would this be a PG movie with that fucking parking garage scene.
Oh, yeah.
Dr. Doom fucking blows up.
That's what I mean by he's in a guy's different chest. Movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's in a
sci-fi horror movie.
Oh, yeah, totally. No, he is in a movie that Connor would watch from Movie Dumpster. Like, to be honest.
Probably.
I would say, I love him as Doom. He just...
Oh, like, no, you're right. Again, he's in a different film.
He's just bad Michael Fassbender. Like, that's he's true. Exactly that.
Oh, my God.
Yes.
And nothing else.
Such a mean thing to say, unexpectedly.
that's what truth. He is.
I know. I kind of
so
agree.
Much like him... Mm-hmm. And so much like I feel like maybe Michael Fassbender watched this movie and oh man, I could do comic book movies like 10 times better than this guy. And then
there's 2 years between this and 300, so that kind of works.
Yeah, but Julian McMahon was big. Like, he had been doing stuff he did Nip Tuck for forever. That's the first thing I saw him on was Charmed, but I love Nip Tuck, and that was what I watch, and he was a great bad kind of this character on that. And he is basically, since none of you watched it but me, he is basically this character on Runaways.
Huh. Okay, here's my problem with Doom and Reed. It's a problem with two of them, is that guy may be good elsewhere, but I don't think he's very good here, because especially with like the, I don't know who the actor is who plays Reed, but they're both like two of the most indis, like disposable, just white dudes, like from the Lifetime channel. It's the same performance and the same character, basically. It's like, Victor, I'm here to do the science. That's good, Reed. Do the science. I've done the science. Let's do the science together.
They're both in a soap opera, both of them, but different soap operas.
Well, Reed is a guy. He's a British guy. The only other things I remember him from, he was in King Arthur movie that was like supposed to be historically accurate.
He was also in one of James Cameron's fucking 3D fetish movies.
He was in a shitty TV show. That was in a CW show. It was like a CBS show where it's like
he
would die every episode. It was a procedural.
Yeah, it was not. It was Highlander, but worse.
He has a tiny role in Titanic, and that's the only thing I've seen him in, actually.
Really? What is he in Titanic?
He's just a ship officer that escapes the boat.
A literal nobody?
You look him up on Google, and that's the third thing that comes up. So.
Okay, so let's talk about how this fucking movie just rushes to the fact that they get superpowers.
I love that fact.
I don't know. I felt like the movie was like, hey, look. And I was like,
That was the biggest misstep they could have taken.
So I think it was great. Like, I thought it was like, I don't, like, why do we need to spend so much time on the, like, let's just get to the powers?
Because they need to establish why we should care about them as a family.
Even an extra 10 minutes of establishing who these people are would
maybe
have
we're arguing two different things. Like, it's not me arguing, well, like, oh, we should have all this time to like see who they are. I'm just like, I don't want to take too long. I don't want the origin story to be an hour.
The problem is the time in between the start of the movie when they get their powers is full of absolutely nothing.
Yep.
It's just them sniping each other for like, I don't know, 15 minutes, and then bam, cosmic storm.
Right.
Yeah. I guess.
It's a lot of like jokes and quips. And then
that office scene, I feel like we get a lot of backstory that's already happened. We're like, oh, Reed and her already dated. Everybody hates Victor because only he would build a 30-foot statue of himself in front of his own building.
Yeah. A statue that they reused in Amazing Spider-Man 2, probably. For anybody who remembers that film.
I just want to say about Victor real quick in that fucking parking lot scene where, like, maybe you should go back to Latveria. I'm like, what fucking country is Latveria when this dude's speaking American, like, the whole time? Like,
they're... The entire handling of Latveria in this movie is laughable.
Right. It is. The people who gave him that weird-ass fucking art piece mask.
For your achievements in the humanitarian efforts, here is this spooky chrome
That's
mask.
That's not the mask that you give for that. That's the mask
sincerely,
you give.
Sincerely, the people of Latveria.
You were a dictator. We hate you. Get out of here. Here's this mask. This is how much we hate you.
Maybe I built up my own backstory for him.
I was going to say, I think like the biggest problem, one of the many big problems this movie had was that they expected everyone to know who the Fantastic Four was and go in and tell the story the way they did with that expectation. But then they decide to staple on, no, let's do an origin story too. Like, you can't have it both ways. Like, if you're going to start this movie and just jump right into them having powers, cool. That would have been a much better film than what we got. But it was of two minds. It was trying to be like, no, you know who these people are. We don't have to establish anything, but let's tell you an origin story anyways.
Yeah.
And the origin story is like, it's over before it starts. And then you're left with these people afterwards, and it's just, they just fucking bicker and argue and are awful to each other. And then at the end, they do a fucking family pose, and you're like, oh, that was completely unearned.
It would have been better if it was way more tongue-in-cheek. They got rid of the origin thing altogether.
Well, I would definitely agree with that. Like, I think maybe at this point in 2018, like, we can get rid of the origin point. Maybe I just have a dysfunctional family and I related to this family a little bit more.
I mean,
tell us more, Lou.
The testament.
I'm not going to say that there aren't clever things. Like, the fact that when Johnny enters the room, he says, officer on deck or something like that. That's a clever thing to do. If the rest of this movie were as clever as that line is, this movie would be a much better movie.
Yeah,
I think Chris Evans does an amazing job with like Johnny Storm. He like, does. That's Johnny because Storm.
He's Captain America. He can do anything.
Yeah.
No, I will agree with that, Lou. Like, I did notice that Chris Evans did do a good job. He played the character like you expect Johnny Storm to be played.
Exactly.
I will say that.
And I would say Chiklis did the same thing with Ben.
I agree with that as well.
I think somebody, an executive or something, had to really like the character of Ben Grimm, because there's a lot of, like, there is a fair amount of care put into how he's presented.
Well,
there's only one thing from Ben Grimm's history that we haven't gotten in any of the movies, really.
Yankee
we
got, like,
Oh, were we going to say Hunter?
Yankee Street? Is that what you're
yes.
Say?
I was yes. going to say, well, Yankee Street and the fact that he's Jewish.
Yeah.
Because, like, both of those things are a huge part of Ben Grimm's backstory.
Yeah, they are. They are. And we kind of got that when he was at the bar in Brooklyn.
Yes. That's like, what I was going to say. But even in the newer movie, we don't get any of that.
In the newer movie, Ben is insultingly underwritten. Like, he's. You can almost be forgiven for forgetting what actor played Ben before he gets turned into a rock monster.
Yeah. Well, Ben might as well have not been in the.
Yeah.
Well, he never met Mara, which is the most hilarious thing about that movie, that they were never together ever.
Mm-hmm. And at the end of that, they do the same thing. They walk into their new facility and they do a big old hero pose and like, ha ha ha, joke. And then the movie ends. It's like, you didn't earn any of this.
Yeah.
I did love their, like, the way the backstory, like, I loved all the, like, the design work for the time period. Like,
I will say, making the Baxter building is kind of, like, lovingly made in this movie.
It is.
This movie is not bad. This is actually a very good-looking movie.
Yeah,
it's
very bright.
Except that space station that looks like something out of Galaxy Quest.
Maybe I'm remembering, but, like, this movie felt to me like it can completely fit into the Tobey Maguire Spider-Man, universe.
I can
totally see Spider-Man swinging in and being like, hey, what's up?
But it's weird because this is Fox, and their most successful franchise at this point is X-Men. So if there's any franchise you're going to try to fit this into and make it feel like it would be that one.
Wasn't there talk of an X-Men Fantastic Four crossover?
With
like,
the newer one.
With the newer ones.
Yes,
Ew.
No, I believe there was a point when Sony and Fox were thinking about doing their own verse when the MCU was starting to kick off.
That was certainly a rumor at some point of them teaming up to combat Marvel,
and
Universal sat in the corner and cried like a little child.
No, the skeleton that had Namor's rights moved its jaw briefly.
For a second, and it looked over in their direction.
They're like, but he has wings on his feet.
Fantastic Four and X-Men movie.
I mean, what would they have called it, though? Is there a team that's just those characters?
No.
FX?
No!
They could have done the... because that's the Hulk is with, what, Paramount? Because I was going to say they could have done the new Fantastic Four, because that's Wolverine, Spider-Man, Ghost Rider, and
Universal.
Hulk.
No, but they could have done instead of... they could have squeezed someone else in there besides Hulk.
Yeah. Yeah. They could have just let Ben Grimm in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean,
and there's a fair amount of practical stunts in this movie. I really liked the fact that I'll see like an actual actor sail through the air and get destroyed by something. Speaking of which, that doorman that Doom fucking
wrecks his shit
missiles through, but that looked like the most. That was the most painful looking stunt I've seen in recent memory. That dude got fucked all the way up. He got thrown so hard he landed back on his feet, and then fell over.
I like Doom in this movie because Doom just doesn't give a fuck.
I saw G.I. Joe before I saw this. He's way too desperate.
Well, I think that's the reverse biting off of. I think they kind of bit off of this.
Yeah.
Probably.
I mean, I hope nobody was biting off of anybody in either of those situations.
Yeah. It's Hollywood. They bite off of each other all the time.
I hope that they were looking up, though, not down.
Saying that Doom doesn't give a fuck is a complete misunderstanding on the studio's part of what makes Doom an interesting villain.
He's more in a way of like him just like kind of attacking things. I know what you mean.
Yeah, it just that's where I think a lot of the issues for this for me, other than it being a horrible movie, were that it fundamentally misunderstood what made the Fantastic Four an interesting comic and team.
Yeah.
And it just it showed that they didn't give a shit. They just were like, we have the rights, let's do it.
Yeah.
Well, I do think that played into the creation of this movie. Is like they had to make a movie, otherwise
yeah, it would have reverted to Marvel.
Yeah, and like I don't get this, like, Fox's desire to constantly, well, I suppose only twice, but go this far out of the box as to recreate Doom. Like, in either situation, it's like, well, that's really not even close.
Okay, this Doom is closer than the other Doom.
To be fair, I don't know how to do a comic book accurate version of Doom well. I have no idea how you would actually do that.
I think in the world that MCU has built now, he could fit in, because now that you have magic in the MCU, that's where they scienced him in this one, where he has electrical powers.
Also, now you have T'Challa and M'Baku, like you have characters who are also leaders.
Yeah, those
like
characters exist now, but even Iron Man 3, it wouldn't have worked then. That's why the Mandarin doesn't use magic, people.
Mandarin is a terrible stereotype.
No, and here's the thing.
As an Asian, I kind of like that character.
Right.
Well, here's the thing. I love the idea of what they're trying to present the Mandarin as in Iron Man 3, which is like this contemporary Osama bin Laden-like character. I'm glad they didn't go with the stereotype thing. Instead, he comes off as a modern-day terrorist.
Yeah.
See, I would have preferred, I don't remember when, it was around the same time in the actual Extremis series they did with Iron Man. I like the boardroom Mandarin, him wearing a suit, and him just being this like leader in China, this like kind of behind the scenes.
Like,
I'm fine with that version.
What the fans that were complaining wanted. That's not the version they wanted. The guy in the hat with the rings that are magic.
Also, I'm so happy with
they wanted the magic rings guy who summons Fing Fang Foom or whatever.
Well, technically, the rings aren't magic. They're actually alien technology.
I don't care.
They're the same dragons that Iron Fist fights, right?
Yeah.
Also, those people can go complain on Rorschach's blog.
I agree. Those people are wrong.
I'm going to never let that go.
I'm glad we agree with that. That those people who want the magic ring racist Mandarin, that those people are wrong. I'm glad that we're on the same page on that.
So Doom's a, I don't think he's a very good villain in this movie.
No, he's fine though. Like he is the most interesting part of this movie to me. Everything else is kind of, it's fine. It's serviceable.
He becomes way too mustache trolly for me.
His motivation is questionable, but like he is. When I think of Doom, I think of this kind of big, bold personality that is being presented in this movie.
I will say about Doom movie, they do the kind of like, they hint at the Jack Kirby kind of like, Dr. Doom isn't really heavily scarred under the mask. It's just one scar, but his ego can't take it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
They kind of hint at that, and then they immediately do away with it. Like,
yeah, and then they turn him into Shepard from Mass Effect 2 after he was rebuilt by Cerberus.
Yes.
Yeah. Just shit sticking out of him.
I know it's not this movie, but if you go to the second movie, I think they continue to do it. If you carry that character over, they do a good job of bringing him back to being what he is kind of in the beginning and middle of this movie, which is like this egomaniac, like, I can do everything better, I just need power.
I mean, I guess. I will have to get to that when we get to that movie, but
I'm trying my hardest to defend this.
I know you are, and you're doing an admirable job. I will say that. Okay, let's talk about the butt rock. Five-year-old butt rock.
Some 41 is the best part of this whole movie. I was laughing my ass off at fucking nails.
No, it's hilarious, gentlemen. But it doesn't need to be there.
Can I present to you? Could someone take my cigar from me? Can I present to you every time we see Johnny Storm on the screen, we play some of that alternative music that the kids love so much? Does that sound like $1 million idea?
That sounds great, Frank.
Thank you.
That's Chris Evans, who's a big hit with the ladies, let me tell you.
And Jessica Alba's cleavage. It needs to be there as much as we can.
Oh, get out of here with that. That's all already here. That's already in the script. Don't worry.
Titillation cells. Come on. Boobs.
We need to make it as close as we can and just almost hit R-rated with her cleavage.
She's the Invisible Woman. Why can't she just wear bra and panties?
She's the girl, not woman.
Oh, fuck. Can't I forgot about that part.
Yeah. If she's over 27, that's way too old.
Jesus Christ.
There's a glaring butt rock in this movie, and it dates the movie horribly, because when's the last time anyone heard from Sub 41?
I actually saw them 2 months ago.
Actually, there's the porn, apparently.
Yes, I saw them in D.C. at the old Redskin Stadium. They were the headliners, and before them was Shaggy.
Oh
wow. Did you just wake up from a coma, Lou?
I was supposed
to... God, hold on, who opened? Vertical Horizon?
No.
You're gonna say some other fucking...
No, it was Real Big Fish.
Another band who's a victim of the 90s.
That was both too old and too young for this concert.
But yeah.
That montage later on in the movie where it features Johnny and Ben doing the shenanigans, like, it's that fucking horrible Shimmer-esque knockoff voice.
from me and Alan doing the Smallville thing, like, that is this era.
Yeah,
I know.
It is. I remember I told you, there's the second episode of that show, they play 5 songs, and there's a guy that's name is Bug driving a VW listening to Papa Roach.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
This is that era.
Yeah, I mean, I thought Daredevil was the depths of how bad a soundtrack for a superhero movie can be, but if it weren't for Evanescence on that soundtrack, this one would be worse.
I'd like to counterpoint with Ghost Riders in the Sky.
Well, okay, that song is amazing.
Well, they took
yes.
a good song and they made it shitty.
Speaking of Johnny Storm and all the extreme music, the point when he first starts manifesting his powers and he ends up burning a large pit into the snow and just says to the nurse, oh, hey, you want to jump in?
With Maria Menounos, star of every opening to every movie that you've ever seen in the last 10 years.
Oh, yeah, she was every, so pretty.
Every
what
opening...
The fuck? What the fuck is wrong with that woman? What
I don't know.
Like, you just saw a man light himself on fire, and you're just like, yeah, I'll fuck him.
Yeah, sex I'll time is good.
Yeah, but the thing is, Eric, he's hot.
I mean,
fuck you. Fuck you.
Lou, you beat us. You win.
I mean,
the show's over now.
We've mentioned how Jessica Alba is basically just used as a sex object in this movie, and it is criminally bad. Like, when they first show up in their blue suits, their what will become their Fantastic Four suits, like, her zipper's the only one halfway down for no reason. She's constantly just having her boobs hang out. You can tell it's obnoxious. And then Ben goes to talk to his girlfriend after he gets turned into a big old rock monster, and he's like,
oh, Debbie, that miserable cow.
Remember when we said forever? She's like, yup, and then he steps in the light and she goes, oh my god, monster, get away from me, and we never see her again.
Like the woman from a 1940s monster movie.
She puts her engagement ring on the ground and he can't pick it up because of his giant rock monster fingers.
What a fucking bitch.
Yep.
Yeah. Fucking Lori.
What did you call her?
I called her a miserable cow.
Yeah, I was going to say that's the wrong C word.
I mean, yeah.
Can you talk about how big of a bitch Sue Storm is to read in that restaurant?
Okay, well, like, at first, everyone that's seen is written like an imbecile. Like,
yeah.
I feel like it is a little... Reed is obviously snooping in somebody else's relationship, which is pretty shitty. Like, and then Sue obviously sees that he's trying this and kind of baits him and then and then shouts him down at the same time.
Yep.
He's like, I'm happy for you and Victor. This is coming from a man who clearly is trying to get over our breakup, and I'm trying to be a better man. Ew, why don't you fight for what you want?
Yeah. Why don't you worship the ground I walk on, Reed?
Here's my one defense, though. Is this the best Jessica Alba can do? So I'm looking at her IMDb,
I mean,
this might be the best she can do.
She was in Machete.
What was she in Machete?
If that's your argument, then I go back to, then Tim Story should have cast somebody better.
That's my point. Like
Rachel McAdams was considered for a role, and she's
so much better. But Jessica Alba was put in this movie for racial diversity. I will say that as someone who is Hispanic.
Here's the thing: if they left her hair and eyes alone, I would agree with you. But they
But they did that. It doesn't matter. She's still Jessica Alba, but they just bleach her hair and put very visible blue eye contacts.
Right.
In her eye. Yeah, she looks very like processed.
She looks out of place. She looks wrong in a.
You mean when I look at Chris Evans and Jessica Alba, I'm like, oh, those two can be related.
Yeah, they can easily be adopted. As something that they figured out by the 2015 movie, apparently.
Yeah.
Actually adopted in the comic.
No,
they were siblings in the
comic. Brother and sister.
But it works.
Yeah. I thought I was hallucinating for a second there.
I mean, like, it totally works that Kate Mara was adopted in the 2015 movie. It's totally believable, except for the fact that those two have no chemistry with each other, which we'll talk about more in 2025. You can easily do that. And here's the thing, like, these two don't even have any chemistry. Like, I don't believe that they're brother and sister at all in this movie, whatsoever.
Well, it's like you said, everyone's giving a performance for a different movie, so nothing ever clicks.
Well, because Chris Evans is doing his best, like, 2000, like, teen action, I don't know, not another teen movie that he was in. That's what he's in.
He's like he's a tertiary character from Out Cold, more or less. Like,
yeah.
Oh my God.
Eve 6 should follow him wherever he goes.
Yes, and it does.
I'm sure it does. And then Alba is just, I don't know, she's just like, her performance ranges from like, yeah, to just nothing.
But like, again, like, I would read you off her IMDb, but it's basically, I'm looking here, Dark Angel, Sin City, Fantastic Four, Into the Blue, Four Silver Surfer, Good Luck Chuck, starring Dane Cook.
Oh my God.
Love Guru.
Oh no.
Again, like, just cast somebody else. I'm sorry, just cast somebody else.
I want to talk about one action sequence in me that bothered the shit out of me because of how it's structured. It was designed by a madman because it's after Ben goes to the bridge and all this nonsense happens. Like, they for all intents and purposes cause a multiple car pile up on a bridge. Mm-hmm. They cause it. Ben shoulder checks
the
truck.
Ben does it all. He does everything.
Yeah. He shoulder checks the truck and then acts like a hero and tries to get the guy out of the truck.
He's then, the monster like, that he looks
this,
like.
This fucking bedlam ensues, and then by the end of it, all these people are like, "Yeah, they saved us!" I'm like, "They put you all in mortal danger first." Yeah.
It would be like,
can we talk about how the fucking reporters on that bridge had more information than they should have? There was like, one of them's like, "I heard, is it true you can fly?" I'm like, "Motherfucker, you don't even know this person exists."
Okay, can we talk about how those firemen were the worst firemen ever? Because
oh my,
just
okay.
charging
the firemen,
in
the
with
fireman
a fucking
was...
dog on in the fire truck.
Yeah,
why
with
did
the
have a
well,
dog.
This
the
is
fireman
2005.
Was where I started laughing hysterically because, like, with the fucking ladder gag, where like it just kept falling and people were attached to it. That's when I just started giggling because I was like, "This movie has reached levels of absurdity I wasn't ready for."
Again, this is 2005, a couple years after 9/11 in New York City. They can't do anything that makes cops and firemen look bad.
Right, but they cannot make the Fantastic
they
Four
look
bad.
They do make them
look
super bad.
They do.
But then the fireman goes to the cops and goes, "No, this guy's cool."
Yeah.
This giant orange rock monster guy.
I mean,
then 5 minutes later, they have thousands of fans.
Yep. It's really weird.
Well, okay. So, shortly after that entire accident scene, and they're getting medical attention, whatever you want to call it. How the fuck is that TV picking up any reception? Like, there is no cable running to it. There is no antenna. It's in the middle of a bridge in New York City.
Wait, was it plugged in even? Was it even plugged in?
Who knows? Who knows? Well, because who cares?
I can challenge you with a great aggression, and this is going to jump to the very end of the movie. When Kerry Washington, yes, Kerry Washington, is standing there with Ben Grimm, and they're having sexy talk, what is she implying is happening between them?
I don't know.
It's like she'd be giving a hand job to some asshole.
We gotta make a joke about the rock dick. He's got a rocky penis. We gotta make fun of the joke.
She was implying more of like what he was doing. His one finger is the size of a Coke can. What the hell is going on?
I don't know.
You know... Maybe Ben was into some real freaky stuff beforehand.
It's definitely her. She's a blind lady.
Yeah.
What does that mean?
Even as a child, I remember thinking, "Wait, how does that work?"
We've already seen that he has no rocket.
Here's how it works. She dies. That's the
exactly. Yeah. Like she gets internal bleeding, and then she dies.
That's the
thing is, she's a secret Skrull.
And there she turns. Oh God! God damn it, Lou! She turns into a drainage pipe once, and that's it. She's done. Speaking of her, like, she was very forward when they were at the bar. Like, my comment was just like, hey, my face is up here, blind lady. Like, she just goes straight for the stomach and chest. Like, that's not where people's heads are when you want to see what they look like.
He's a rock, so he never needs to get Viagra. He's always hard.
God damn it.
This was when I was thinking, like, I'm like, this movie is now rapidly approaching Batman Forever and Batman Robin levels of, like, what the fuck is going on?
Mm-hmm. Well, it was shortly after the bartender left the bar that had customers to walk the blind woman home that I was like, all right, I'm just going to stare into the abyss for the next 30 minutes. Oh, look, it's the ending. Okay, cool.
What's sad about that is the shot right before the sequence right before that when he breaks the stool, I was like, it was so good when he's like, yo, you guys, this is the first mook from Brooklyn to ever make into space. Don't say shit. I was like, oh, that's actually a really good kind of sequence. And then it's like, oh, blind black lady wants to get fingered by a rock monster.
God fucking damn it.
That's a pull quote right there.
God damn it. I was going to say something about geology, but I can't even think.
This is FXXX.
Can we talk about how she's the only female character in this movie that's not a terrible piece of shit? Like,
yeah.
They're all terrible, except for the one blind lady.
Yeah.
There are other women in this movie besides her, Jessica Alba?
Well, Laurie, once again, Laurie from The Walking Dead, who I'm convinced is the same character, by the way.
Oh, and there's the two old ladies in the car.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah,
I think one of them is in a car commercial for insurance now.
Probably. I believe it. Can we talk about the X Games also? And how dated that is?
Sponsored by Activision?
I really thought that this was like a cutaway to Daredevil. Not Daredevil, Ghost Rider.
Mm-hmm. It's so weird.
It's that time period, though. The X Games were a thing.
I do remember watching the commentary for Ghost Rider and the director being like, well, they did something like this in Fantastic Four, and it like it just really bothered us. Like, we didn't know what to do, so we had to push the movie back. We're gonna come back to, and I was like, "Oh, I feel sorry for you." Actually,
imagine being that heartbroken over a fucking X Game sequence.
Yeah,
I really had to get those sponsored bikes in there. I'm really upset about it. It really stifled me creatively.
Can we talk about the sponsors at that fucking?
That's what I said to my wife too.
Activision.
Pack, there's Burger King. There's Activision, Xbox,
Code Red. Like, there's everything.
They were probably all actual sponsors of the X Games.
No, they're sponsors of the movie. That's what that was. Yeah. That was them trying.
I'm not
get
saying
some
that they're mutually
back.
Exclusive. I'm saying they're probably also both.
Do you guys know if there were Burger King Fantastic Four toys? Because it feels like there might have been.
I feel like there must have been.
They probably had glasses come out actually with the ones that were made of lead paint that will kill you if you drink from them over too long time.
Actually,
much like this movie.
They're really nice ones, like Batman Forever.
Like, I'm pretty sure I have a Thing toy from this movie, actually, that came probably from either McDonald's or Burger King. So, at least in Canada, they did those.
Can I do one more defense? I want to say, to me, I thought their costumes were actually, of this time period, awesome.
I mean, they're fine.
They were good.
They weren't fucking black leather suits. That's why.
Yes, that's why. Yeah, I was going to say, yeah. It wasn't the Matrix.
Okay. Yeah.
And to some extent, I can understand that defense, too, because I feel like Fox might have been trying to make this, like, the happy, fun movie since, X-Men had gone a darker turn.
That's why I say, like, I feel like this fits more with the Spider-Man Raimi-verse than with the other X-Men, where they're all in the Matrix leather outfits.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Where everyone's dressed the exact same way.
Okay, it looks like there were toys. I'm seeing
okay,
a
I do
thing
want to
toy.
Say, like, I do want to say that, like, I think when Doom shows up in, like, the look, it looks fine. However, looks like, I'm like, where did he get the rest of that?
Yeah, like, where?
He just had that in his closet. He
just shows up and, like, he's like, this is my supervillain costume now.
Because he's awesome? Like, where does most of these super this is 2000 in 2005 where do all these other supervillains get their outfits?
But like it's like he goes into the next room and comes out in a full suit of armor. I'm like, when did you plan this?
He also walked into his warehouse murdering his own employees to get a rocket launcher.
This is
very true.
Yeah.
Look at where like his like outfit, wardrobe, like that thing. Like, where the fuck did that come from? Like,
that's what I mean. Like, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't know you had a Dark Lord cape stored in your fucking closet one day with big giant fucking chrome buttons on it. Like,
all I have to say is, I dare you to tell me that Zuckerberg doesn't have one in his closet.
Oh, I think he wears it like he wears women's underwear. Like, he walks in front of his mirror with like his Overlord outfit on.
He's like,
now you don't have to be a human today, Mark.
I'm a Dark Lord. I'm a Dark Lord. I own Facebook.
I am the Dark Lord. Is this how human beings eat their food with their hands? I will do it. This pleases the Zuckerborg.
I have a plus 13 dexterity.
Anyway, is this better than Rise of the Silver Surfer, or is it worse?
It's the same. it's just more of this.
The problem is different answers. Everyone was like,
the problem is, if you take out Galactus from Rise of the Silver Surfer, that's better. But Galactus is so bad, it tanks that whole thing.
Yep.
Andre Brower doesn't help it either. I'm gonna have to disagree with Lou on an earlier point. I think Doom really hurts that movie because he's unnecessary. You don't need him in that movie at all. And he's in this movie, he's chewing the scenery. In that movie, he's eating everybody else. He's chewing on the other actors.
He's so good at it.
I mean, good is a one word that you could say, yes, I guess.
I would say of any like comic book character, of Doom is the most chewing the scenery character that exists.
Yes, and that's why I like him in this. In the second one, he goes a few steps too far, if you ask me.
I don't think there's such a thing. Or Doom. Like, Doom, to me, in my head, is the most cartoonish version of a supervillain in every single level.
To me, Dr. Doom is supervillain. Like, he's...
Yeah.
He's the guy. Like, you don't get a more evil dude than Dr. Doom. But, like, in this movie, he just feels like a fucking goober. Like...
He's unnecessarily gaudy. Like, the fucking V he has behind his chair is the most ridiculous thing.
Yeah.
I see all that stuff, and I'm like, yeah, that's what Doom would do in 2005. He would be a giant corporate douche.
I guess.
He's just Elon Musk in 5 years.
Yeah, he is. Yeah. That's really the problem, is he's too real. he's too close to reality, unfortunately.
Yeah, it's once Elon Musk controls the internet, then he will unveil his evil plan.
Right.
You know, at this point, I give it to Elon Musk. You can have it.
Here's the thing. I believe if he was more like Elon Musk, though, in this movie, I would believe that humanitarian award thing. Like,
yeah.
I don't believe second that he would get that.
Let's address that real quick, just like the rationale of it. Like, he is a cold prick with this entire film. Like, what humanitarian efforts could you conceivably make me believe he did?
Right.
Like, would he drop a bunch of food over some impoverished country and said, take it, you fucking beggars?
Is it just that he continues to pay taxes to Latveria? Is that it?
Yeah, like,
he writes a check. That's all it is. That's all you need to do to get an award. You write a check,
I guess.
That's the pessimist in me that's like, oh yeah, he's a bad guy, he just writes checks and then they give him awards.
Maybe that's why they gave him the mask, as like a sarcastic present. Like, we're gonna give you a supervillain mask.
Here, you evil fuck.
You know what it probably is? It's just him opening a bunch of factories there to get really cheap labor, and that's how he gets an award.
Because
he pays off the government to have those factories.
Yeah. The award came from Von Doom Industries.
Yeah.
He's like, here at Von Doom, we promote from within.
Compared to his board members, he's definitely not the most evil-looking person.
That is true. That is very
And I
true.
Did love the fact that his assistant is the dude from Legion. That's all burnt up.
I was waiting for somebody to say that. He hasn't aged a day.
He reverse aged.
Yeah, he looks better now.
Mm-hmm.
And he's the only one that notices that, oh, maybe he's still alive, and like kind of shudders away at the end of the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. And even the action was like It was just mostly, I don't know, it was lots of clanging and banging and cars getting tossed, but never really ever fucking landed.
I do like the final action sequence with them versus Doom. Like, it's well executed, I guess. I like that they use their powers together, I suppose.
Oh, actually, while we're here, like, the presentation of their powers, I thought, was probably one of the strongest parts of this movie, because I do think that the Mr. Fantastic first arm stretch under the door doesn't look that bad.
No. It works fine for 2005.
I watched it on Blu-ray. Of all the powers, his are the worst in current time.
Nothing murders old CGI like Blu-ray.
Yeah.
Well, it's silly to compare it to an animated film, but when you see that scene of Elastigirl between the two doors in the lair, which is like 100 times better than anything in that film and just feels and looks really good, it's just like it's really lacking.
Well, the problem is when they try to replicate skin. Yeah. Like when it's the suit,
it looks like Silly Putty.
Yeah.
It's got
Sue's powers look amazing, and Johnny's look. I don't even know how they would do different.
Hers is just you turn down the opacity. Like that's.
Yes. I mean, like, they do everything in a kind of, and I don't mind how they explain. They're like, oh, you're not actually going invisible, you're bending light.
Right.
It's like, oh, I didn't mind the nosebleeds. Like, I thought that was interesting.
Yeah, that was cool. There's stuff in here that's fine. Like, there's stuff in here that's competent. I will say that for sure. Like, I think that when Johnny is trying to escape Doom's missiles, that sequence is actually very fun.
And with Johnny, like, how if you can fuck up making a man covered in fire, you don't deserve to work in the industry. So right. I think that was too easy.
And he looks good also. Fire, as Connor knows, is a very difficult thing to get right.
When it looks fake, it is the most distracting thing in the world. And then when you're not noticing it is when it's done well.
And
I would say, like, with Doom, like, I don't mind the kind of idea that they were going for in this movie. It just, to me, it falls apart at the end when they're doing their big fight. I'm like, oh, so he's just a metal dude now.
That was something they took directly from the Ultimate Fantastic Four, too.
The, like, metal skin infection or whatever?
I would have preferred if they gave him the ultimate goat legs that they did in that.
Goat legs? That's cool.
Yeah, yes. He has backward legs in Ultimate.
Wow. What is he, a creature from The Arrival?
That's very metal.
And then he hangs out with homeless people and shit.
Yeah.
Why?
Oh, I thought...
Because
he's a man
of the people.
I thought Doom 2099 was as weird as this shit gets. Apparently not.
Oh, no.
No, yeah, Ultimate Doom is bananas.
No, I also wasn't a big fan of just the fact that he's just a metal man. Like, it's...
As far as this character is concerned, the way that they do him, giving him, like, a reason, like, he's presumably dying because of that metal thing or whatever that's going on... So I guess that's interesting, but it's not necessary. I do kind of like that he gets his powers from the satellite, I guess. That's the idea that we're going with, is that because he's the only one in that room, he gets metal skin or whatever.
See, I'm glad you understood that, because I didn't. I didn't know the reason or
well, it's,
logic for any of his powers.
It's throwaway.
They all got powers kind of what they were doing, and Ben's was the most fucked up because he got it with completely no protection.
Yeah.
Well, and yeah, exactly. He wasn't even wearing the unstable molecule suit, which I will admit that was the one scene where I was like, oh, that's not bad, when they showed them getting hit with the cosmic rays.
Right.
Like that I didn't think looked bad.
Yeah.
And the whole thing that where Doom's powers are coming from, it's a throwaway line before he murks that doctor.
Yeah.
Organic
metallic something. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like the metal on my spaceship or whatever. The shields on my satellite or whatever, something like that.
And I kind of wonder if the doctor in a cutscene told him, oh yeah, also you're losing your penis. And that's why he ended up killing him.
Like the picture I showed, Ultimate Doom does not have a dick.
Yep. I mean,
very true.
That guy was a doctor, and he was also totally in love with Doom. Like,
yeah, pretty much.
I did love the...
Why the fuck Doom?
I don't know where you're getting that, but I'm into it. I can see it.
He hates Sue Storm. Clearly, he wants to fuck Doom.
I did love the whole Reed and Ben situation, like him even doing the promise on the bridge.
Yeah.
And then Doom using that whole thing against him. I was like, oh, that was probably the best plot thing in the entire movie.
I mean,
was Doom using that.
And
that
it works in Ben's favor because, like, Reed is shown doing nothing throughout the film. It's like, I'm working on it. Are you, though?
And I mean, it's smart for Doom to say, like, I got to get rid of Ben because Ben can kick my ass. That was really smart. And it,
well, it's also, it showed the weakness of Reed, which is that he overthinks everything,
including moving in together.
Yes.
God, that was so dumb.
Yes, the way the factors.
That was
the variables.
There were too many variables. Motherfuckers, you. Of course, you're not married.
Like, anybody that's going to you tell me you have to outweigh stuff like, oh, should I move in with Jessica Alba? I don't know.
Yeah.
That was.
I also like the incredibly forced touch of gray on Reed, where it's like, oh, look, the cosmic storm gave you gray hair. Isn't that funny? Never speak
Which
of it again.
Isn't it was even just that like, noticeable.
Yeah. It's just like Rogue in X1 at the end of X1.
Yeah, they give her a gray strand for reasons.
Yeah.
Well, it's like, okay, it's this whole philosophy of we either have to go as far away from the source material as possible, or we have to be so, so committed to it, depending on what day that they were making the movie.
They're so committed to it, yet want to make compromises.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
It's like, well, where can we not compromise? Oh, this gray hair is fine, but what about all of this other stuff that you maybe shouldn't be compromising on?
We can't compromise on the gray hair.
We can compromise on the tits.
Exactly.
Look, gray hair is a sign of adulthood, okay?
That's right.
And
it's
a sign of manly, manly men.
The kids, they will love it. I know. I'm a 70-year-old man.
And I'm swinging this cigar around in Hollywood Studios.
I have hepatitis.
My feet are on this table, and I'm in a very long brown suit.
I'm in the same 1933.
Now, someone wind up the Victrola. I want to listen to some music.
I have to make a confession, and that is that when Fantastic Four 2 came out, I was 14, and I think half the reason I went to see it in theaters was because of Jessica Alba. And
I mean, that's a good reason.
You were 14.
I was 14.
Yeah.
So that worked on me.
No,
that makes sense.
I mean,
I was 14 once.
There's a reason I watched Trading Places like 100 times when I was a kid. For those who haven't seen that, Jamie Lee Curtis, things happened to her in that film.
Oh God! Whoa.
Anyways, Fantastic Four.
Honestly, a big question I have is how they chose Tim Story to direct this movie, because coming off of a Barbershop, which has like nothing to do with this.
You didn't know that?
And the horrible Taxi remake featuring Jimmy Fallon and Queen Latifah. Like a remake of a really, really good French action film that is really awful.
You're saying an American screwed up a remake of a foreign film? I can't.
That literally never happens.
Yeah.
Are you saying that you do not like Queen Latifah? Because that's pretty racist.
She's great, but that movie sucks.
Hey, she's in Jersey City.
Oh my God, he made the Ride Along, Think Like a Man 2.
Yeah.
He's
making Son of Shaft.
Yep. No, this
what?
Is what
oh,
his
no.
He is like, making no. the like he... next Shaft film.
Wait, is Samuel Jackson in it?
Yes.
Wait, so it's that Shaft?
It's okay.
The one with Vanessa Williams?
It's the next generation of Shaft after Samuel L. Jackson.
So how do you do a black exploitation movie in 2018?
The Black Dynamite?
Yeah, but that's tongue-in-cheek.
Yeah.
He's a director that makes, like, pretty well-liked comedies with mostly black casts, and then he makes the whitest white comic book movie that ever happened and ever will.
White bread is a good way to describe this movie. It is so fucking, white people.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's so much so that they took the one ethnic and they put her in blonde hair and blue contacts.
Here's the thing.
And the other person of color they made blind.
Yeah.
You can see her, but she can't see you.
If for some reason it had color to it, that would at least make it interesting, but it doesn't. There's nothing about this that makes it unique or interesting on any level whatsoever.
That's what, like, at the very least, like, if they would have done something with Ben and him being Jewish, would have been at least something.
Yeah.
But none of the movies, like, even the newer one, didn't even touch that. In fact,
They don't do anything with Ben Grimm in the 2015 version. Like, Jamie Bell, who's, like, a capable actor, is cast to do nothing. He does nothing.
Yeah. Other than be angry at Miles Teller.
Yeah.
Yeah, but everybody should be, because he's terrible.
That is one of the biggest miscastings I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah.
Like, Miles Teller might be okay at other stuff, but, like, I don't buy him as brainy guy.
I agree with that.
I don't buy him as anything that's not, like, the actually, guy Whiplash.
I think Michael B. Jordan is more miscast, because I think he's so much more than being Johnny Storm.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
Killmonger.
Like, exactly. Killmonger. He's so good as Killmonger. I'm like, thank God that movie tanked. Otherwise, we would have never gotten that.
Yeah. I guess.
I think it is very funny that both Human Torches have gone on to have redemption MCU roles.
Yeah.
Well, true.
There's two people in this movie that are in the MCU and one that's on Gotham.
Oh, that's right.
Michael Chiklis was on Gotham.
Wait, who's the other MCU one?
Dr.
Chris
Doom.
Evans. Yeah.
Dr. Doom is on The Runaways and that's part of the MCU.
Oh, that's not.
Lou, yes, it is. Fuck you, goddammit.
I don't care. It's not part of it. It's not part of it.
Isn't Kate Mara in the MCU film?
No, not
she's
yet.
She's in Iron Man 2. She is.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. She's briefly in it.
She doesn't need money. Her family is so goddamn rich.
That's true. Yeah. But I don't...
I own a football team.
I don't consider the TV stuff canon because I don't care. None of it is canon. Netflix stuff. Right. It's
if
not
I
canon.
If I give you my Hulu password, will you watch Runaways?
It's nothing against Runaways. It's just that...
It's like 10 episodes.
No, here's the thing. I have nothing against it, and I will watch it at some point, but I don't include it in part of the canon. I don't include any of the TV stuff as part of the canon because I know for a fact that Ike Perlmutter is a dick, and he... No, it's too complicated for me to be like, oh, I'm including this in my canon, even though the rest of the TV stuff directly goes against everything the movies is doing, except for when it's something big. It's only when an Ultron happens, or when the entire world gets, or half the universe gets turned to dust, that they acknowledge anything.
Spoilers for Infinity War!
I would actually say the opposite. I think Runaway is connected to stuff because of all the extraterrestrial things.
I guess. Here's the thing. I need to see it, but I don't count the TV stuff as canon.
There's a goddamn dinosaur in the show.
I count the TV stuff as a part of a pocket universe, Lou. It's much easier for my nerd brain to handle. If it's in a pocket universe,
it's also easier to cope with the fact that, like, we're never going to see the Defenders hang out with, like, Captain America.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, never.
That's
never.
Exactly my point.
The longer this goes on, I feel like we're going to get it more.
I mean, when Ike Perlmutter is deposed and hung...
No, it's not when he's deposed. It's when someone opens the Ark of the Covenant in front of him and he finally dissolves. And then
I'm saying it's when somebody cuts off his head like a...
When we finally lead the revolution against Ike Perlmutter,
we'll keep his head in a sack, and then we want to turn our enemies to stone. We just pull him out and have him stare at him.
We're like 2 weeks away from Cloak and Dagger.
Again, we're gonna do a pilot review. I'm not counting that as part of the larger canon. It's part of the TV canon. I have no problem believing that Runaways is in the same universe as Daredevil, because it's the TV verse, and they're doing more to make the TV shows canon with each other than they are making the movies canon, for me at least so far. Again, I haven't seen it though, so I really don't know.
So to connect back to Fantastic Four, something you were touching on a little bit when we talked about Incredibles, Lou, or I'm reading the future. Anyways, you had talked about how potentially how they could be reintroduced to the Marvel Universe, the actual Marvel Cinematic Universe. And I'm just curious what everybody else, if anybody else has any interesting ideas reintroduce them.
In response to that, I have a question that I was going to actually ask towards the end of this, which now is the time. Like, is the Fantastic Four, as they are, fundamentally unfilmable?
No.
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 Okay.
No, not at all.
No, they're not, not at all.
And is it just the result of just three straight instances of people in charge just not fucking getting it?
Yes. I think the biggest problem is they're trying to fit a concept from the 1950s, 60s into modern day of that time.
Without whether that's
05 or 2015.
Yeah.
See, I don't even think they need to fit in the context of when they were created into it. I mean, there's a million different ways you could go about having what happened to them happen. It's just nobody has written a good script for these characters.
I also find it interesting. It's one of the only comic book characters who, when it comes to their adaptation and the results of their adaptation, the years they were created are always, like, super relevant.
Yeah. I think it's because,
like, everything else has made the cultural leap just fine, and the Fantastic Four has a little bit of trouble just kind of staying modern.
Yeah,
it's the same thing. The problem with Lost in Space, it's that kind of sci-fi thing of that time period. It's a sci-fi family. That's something that doesn't exist. Like, the modern family doesn't look like that family.
Yeah,
in a weird way. Like, I don't know how else to describe it. Like, it's what it is.
Well, I mean, and looking at, you know, tying someone inexorably to the time period they were created. Like, if I remember correctly, Iron Man, it was what, during the Korean War that he, in the comics at least, that he got the thing stuck in his chest, the shrapnel.
Yeah.
They were able to contemporize it by having him be an arms dealer in the current time period, at least.
The Punisher, you can slap him on seemingly any time period and he's going to work.
Yeah.
As long as there was a previous famous military conflict somewhere, because you just he's a veteran of X.
Yep.
Right.
Yeah.
And with Fantastic Four, it's like, oh, they're superheroes, but they're scientists.
You have two choices with the Fantastic Four. Either you try to keep them the dynamic that they are in the books,
right?
In the original, the 616, or you go with the Ultimate version where they're all straight kids, and it's kind of what that Josh Trank version tried to do,
right?
But it was terrible.
Well,
so you, yes, no, it was terrible.
No, it's terrible in the last half. I will continue.
If one half of something is garbage, it's
no, it, most, yeah, hell, yeah. If here's the thing, if 50% of what you're eating is a shit sandwich,
right?
Would you, like,
it's,
you know,
but it's not. It's not separated shit, evenly through those.
You're going to call it a ham sandwich.
I just watched the first half and then I make up my own movie, so that's how I
like. And then
I can do that with this movie, and this movie is fucking Oscar award winning.
No, it's not. Because it starts off terrible, so it, you don't even have a midway point.
I'm not saying I can cut half of the movie out. I didn't say when the half was.
Oh God.
No, you need to cut it. Like, it needs to be down the middle. And with that movie, with the 2015 movie, I can cut it at a certain point, and the movie that is and the ending that was taken away is a better movie. It's all.
And
like,
here's the thing with Fanforestick. Like, there's a moment in that movie where you can. The sutures become visible of where this movie was stitched together.
Yep. Yeah.
Like,
you can feel the difference.
It's the time jump. Yeah. You're like, this is a different movie now.
It was the same execs. They just crawled out of their graves and they're spitting out grave dirt. Just like, no, you can't do that right there.
I don't know if it's the executive's fault or Trank's fault.
No, it's a combination of both.
I think it's both.
Yeah, little A, little B.
Because everything that comes out of that is that, like, Trank was fucking off the walls.
He was a monster, apparently.
From
what I understand, it was Trank had an idea, and Fox was like, yeah, sure, give it to us. Like, this sounds great. And then when they saw what they were getting, they suddenly got cold feet. And then, like, if I'm Trank, yeah, that sucks. But then the aftermath, you're supposed to conduct yourself like a professional, an adult. Mm-hmm. And everything.
Oh, you mean
when
he destroyed a rental house?
Yeah, he destroyed a rental house, frequently show up, just, like, high off his ass, would not leave his trailer. The cast, I don't think the cast had good things to say about
it. No, they did.
No, there was a leak from one of the main cast members that no one's ever said. But I still think it's Mara, because why does she have any fucks to give? Because she's rich afterwards.
Yeah.
It was just like a shit show. And I do love the fact that he was supposed to do three different shows with Smith, and he did one before the movie came out. And it's a really interesting listen to.
Huh.
Yeah, it's... It's
and then, like, it was so disastrous that, like, Disney came in and took Star Wars away from them. Like, you have to, like,
yep.
Only two men have earned the ire of Disney in that in way. It's fucking three. Colin Trevorrow. Oh, Lord yeah. Miller, I guess.
Yeah.
Fucking. Who am I thinking of right now?
Ant-Man? Is that who you're talking about?
No, because that's that was kind of amicable.
Yeah.
Oh, it's Trevorrow.
Yeah. Trevorrow, what's his face? Fantastic. And then, Lord Miller.
Yeah. Trevorrow's situation is hysterical. It was like, you're going to direct the sequel to one of the biggest openings of all time. No, you're not.
Mm. Well, he wanted to change the end of Last Jedi, apparently. So that's why that happened.
Okay.
To what? I would love to know to what.
He wanted Luke to live. That's the.
That's not possible.
Glad he's dead.
He's not dead. Oh, you meant Luke. I thought you meant Trevor was dead.
I'm glad he's dead. Everyone's like, what do you know? We don't. I'm just like, nothing. Continue.
Nothing. Just watch.
Puts on a Colin Trevorrow mask. No one will know that I'm directing Jurassic World 3.
I don't have his body in the backyard dissolving in a puddle of lye.
Yeah, no, Hunter doesn't put on Colin Trevorrow mask. He puts on Colin Trevorrow's face and just pushes it up like what's his face in Nightbreed.
You guys just randomly reminded me, it's very tangential, but like GSP, who played in Winter Soldier, Batroc. He was just on Rogan, and he did a half-hour conversation how much he loves dinosaurs.
I watched that, and it's mesmerizing. Dude, George St. Pierre is super fun to listen to, let me tell you.
But Joe Rogan, you know, you got this good back kick, and your jiu-jitsu is not impressive. His French accent, I wish where did other Eric go? I just want him to talk.
I'm here. GSP. Yeah, I love GSP. I saw him once at the grocery store near my house because he lived there for a while.
My favorite GSP moment ever, I think it's when Michael Bisping was like showing off to him, and he just leans into a microphone and goes, I am not impressed by your performance.
It's my favorite quote of anything of all time.
Like he has a bad English accent, like, but when you hear him speak in French, he's actually pretty smart and he knows what he's doing. Like he trained in so many things like he did a lot of karate that is not like actually violent, so no, didn't hurt him physically, but just made him like monk-like.
He's talked about it. He was like a super bullied when he was in school.
Yeah.
And that's what got him into martial arts. Yeah, yeah. He's like one of the top greatest martial artists of all time,
but Fantastic Four, everybody.
Yeah,
I don't know if we have too much else to say about it. Like, I don't like as a final thought, I don't like it at all. I'm almost glad I avoided it for so long, and I watched it because I more or less had to, and not because I chose to sit down and spend my time on something I thought I might enjoy.
I would say I don't think this movie is unwatchably bad.
I mean,
I would say you're crazy.
I would say this is the perfect like FX, Spike TV, TNT.
I would put
Sunday
it on
morning.
The background if I was vacuuming my floor.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. That's all I'm saying is that it's worth that. But when you don't like it, you click the vacuum on and you don't have to hear dialogue.
That's not praise, though. That's not.
Yeah, no.
That's.
I saw.
Saying, yeah, it's just as fun as vacuuming.
It's not the spirit.
If my I was... final. Oh, go ahead, Eric.
I was just going to say, if I was blackout drunk at 2 a.m., I wouldn't put this movie on.
God damn.
Yeah, I mean, I watched this movie 13 years ago, like maybe 14, because I probably didn't. I don't remember seeing the theaters. But I mean, that's kind of the crux of my point about it, is that like I forgot so much about this movie, and I'm just praying that I'll do the same after the second watch.
I feel like my defense is that like I think these actors were wasted in a garbage script. I think, except for Alba.
That's not a defense, though.
That's...
Well, I have no other thing to stand
you
on.
You don't know what a defense is, clearly.
what am I supposed to stand on?
Hold on, guys. Defense was in quotes. Let's just
play. Defense. Yeah.
This thing, like the practical effects of this thing, were way better than the CGI we got in 2015.
I'll agree to that.
I guess
the worst part.
If you're talking about Grimm, yes, I applaud them for doing makeup effects in a time when makeup effects were not popular at this moment. This is like
this
is like an ultimate downfall for it.
Seeing it again was like, I honestly think this is way, like, if they can do anything, that they kind of need to go practical with the thing anyway going forward.
I don't know how
you do this team without a practical thing.
I feel like somewhere in between is the best way to go with the thing.
You can touch it up with some CGI, but like, I
think it's because there's such their relationship with the characters, like they're supposed to be so close. So having this big CGI blob that people are just constantly interacting with is distracting.
Yeah.
It's not like the Hulk, where he's Banner, then he's the Hulk, he's Banner. No, he's just the thing. He's just always.
In the same sense, though, I mean, look how well they did it with Guardians. Like, Rocket does seem like a living, breathing part of that team, and all he was James Gunn's brother down on his knees.
The thing with Rocket is that there's no, like, there's no physical aesthetic where you'd get the feeling, like, Ben Grimm in this Fantastic Four looks like if I brushed up against him, he would feel like fucking gravel. Like, it looks tangible.
Mm-hmm. I love all the bits they did with him trying to eat and drink, where he bites the fork. Yeah. When he like picks up a glass and it shatters.
Yeah.
Like all those little tiny touches, I was like, ooh, this is like kind of showing like his life is shit.
There are moments. This would be my final thought. There are moments in this movie where it seems like the director knew what he was doing. Those moments do not make this movie better. They make me more angry at the moments where the director knew not at all what he was doing whatsoever. So fuck this movie, even though I know there are good parts. You clearly knew how to make a good movie, but you decided not to. Or if you want to blame the producers, fine. Blame the producers. But somebody involved with this movie knew how to do their job, and they didn't. So I'm more angry at you for not doing your job. For a producer not stepping in at some point and saying, okay, we can't put this out. This is not a good movie. We need to stop this. So that's my final thought on this.
That's on a note on that. That's pretty much exactly what I said to my wife when we were watching it. Like when I came out of the abyss that I was staring into, I was like, dude, do you honestly believe that the studio saw what was coming out? And they're like, yeah, this is great. We got to get this out. People are going to love it. People are going to love it.
I have so little faith in like higher ups of studios. I think that's what they said.
I mean, I said it on our Steel episode because we haven't done Batman and Robin. And as I've said before, that will be our last movie special. That's where we end it. That's our conclusion because every podcast has done it.
5-hour discussion because it ended like 4 franchises in one movie.
Yes, but I remember saying, if you were in Warner Brothers at that moment and you knew that you have Steel and Batman and Robin on your shelves and that you're about to release both of them within the next 4 months, what do you do when you know that that's going to happen?
It's not even that. They had Steel and Batman and Robin and a Nightwing spinoff, a Superman movie.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
They had so many things spinning.
Like, what do you... If you're the executive and you see those movies and you're not an idiot who thinks that they're great and you understand how bad they are, how many times do you think, I wonder if I could just jump out that window over there?
The paycheck
is too good.
I mean, Avi Arad was also the producer in this film, so right there you have one of your powers that be. Like, Avi Arad is notorious for just being a buffoon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What was that story you had, Connor, about? Was it
Sarah, this is actually going to be new for you, I think. A friend of mine, I will withhold his name, interned at Sony. And had a few good stories about his time while they were producing Amazing Spider-Man 2. He was present for a few minutes during a heated debate between Avi Arad and his son about who should play Electro, because Avi Arad was hell-bent on Channing Tatum. Hell bent. And I guess from what he tells me and how I extrapolate this, like, there's a room full of people going like, no, I don't think you understand why this is a bad idea. And Avi's like, no, Channing Tatum is it.
Well, he definitely saw Magic Mike and was enthralled.
And the other story is that he was one of the interns who had actually had to go run important documents and whatever the fuck back and forth between people. Like, he was basically a runner. And I guess he was one of the people who had to go collect a bunch of fucking Mary Jane-centric comic books, and then he watched as they excise everything he worked for out of the film.
Honestly, that is the best thing that ever happened to that actress's career.
Yeah.
Is it, though?
Do you think that she would prefer to be connected to that movie?
I mean, that's fair.
She still got paid.
The alternate timeline is that the Divergent movie series failed so hard that the fourth one was like, they're like, it's going to be a TV movie. Do you still want to be in it? She's
well, no. I would say, and I don't know why I know this, her character isn't in the fourth book.
Yeah. I don't know. Shailene Woodley still has enough money to make her own shampoo and her own lotion and her
she's
own deodorant.
She's in another movie, and she's in a big HBO show.
I know, but I'm just saying that she's one of those, like, really, like, naturalist people. Yeah, who like
makes well, she's selling rocks stuff. To people. Like,
yes, that's the thing that she's doing. She sells.
She's got crystals.
Who am I talking about? I can't remember.
Shailene Woodley.
But Paltrow.
Yeah. Paltrow.
The one who likes
Woodley
the steam
part
or
of
vagina.
The same, she's part of the same movement as Paltrow. That sort of back to basics.
Shailene Woodley's child.
I mean, can I get do a little work related rant for this topic?
Sure.
I work at an animal hospital, for those who don't know. We have had people come in and say, well, I looked online and did a holistic treatment for my dog because he has diarrhea. I rubbed two magnets on his head.
Oh, my God.
I have such bitterness towards the entire idea of, like, holistic medicine. It just burns my ass.
I'm not going to defend the use of magnets, but there is some truth to some holistic stuff. But you actually have to do the research and see, like, oh, well, yes, this herb has this benefit, but I'm magnets and crystals and bullshit like that. My balls.
Magnets,
my balls.
Magnets.
So I think we're done. I think we're done talking about Fantastic Four.
I have to tell you that only because I listen to Rogan all the time. You should go on Twitter and look up vegan cats. That is a real thing. That is a movement.
That's terrible.
I saw this because there's a woman who has a fennec fox and she's doing the same thing, and like the entire internet is watching this fox waste away. And they're like, you don't understand this thing's diet, and like animal professionals are like, you are killing this animal, and she's like, haters, blah.
You can't do that to cats or foxes. Like, they need a certain amount of animal based protein in their lives. Like, dogs you can actually get away with it. But cats, no.
If we're gonna go into this
route, the planet is doomed.
My two favorite things to point out is that more animals are killed because of the harvesting of vegetables, and that the science of the plants are intelligent. Anytime I meet a vegan.
Yeah. Okay. So if there's anything we should cover, did we go over Incredibles during this episode?
The only thing we don't need to cover is Jessica Alba's sweet, sweet cans. Do you know what I mean, guys?
I know what you mean.
That was way too easy for you.
Hey, they covered her way more than they did The Thing or Dr. Doom.
I mean,
we got full Doom crotch.
That, again, that's not saying anything. That's not saying anything.
There's no song on either.
Yeah.
So, I mean, again, to keep this in line with how this is pairing with Incredibles, this movie doesn't have any heart.
Incredibles is an orbital curb stomp. Yeah. Comparison, because it lands the premise 100 times better than this movie could ever.
Well, The Incredibles is a syringe injected into the idea of the Fantastic Four, pulling out every good element of it, and then making its own movie.
It's even a better movie, like, because it's a better movie set in the time period that Fantastic Four is usually associated with.
Yeah.
Well, it takes the concept and it pulls it out and it rearranges it in a way that makes sense.
And then it adds a creative vision also, which we will be bringing up in a future episode.
Yeah, and it lovingly writes a fan letter to superheroes and like kind of like the old timey pulpy nature of them, because everybody looks very classic in The Incredibles, like their costumes are all very old timey and old school looking. Nobody's in chrome plated armor or has any fucking robotics or shit like that. No. Everyone looks like a fucking old school superhero.
It's very Fleischer-esque, in the best possible way. So that movie does a lot of things that this doesn't. We did suggest possibly in a future episode how we would do Fantastic Four. So did we Do you think we covered that at all, or did we need to do
No, we didn't. We...
How I would do them? Not at all like this.
Agreed.
Yeah, I mean,
if I did this, like, I feel like making them all active combatants is a little too much. Like, it seems like Johnny and the Thing are really all you'd need to go handle a fight. And I feel like any of the braininess or any of, like, the really kind of high-techy planning, strategic, science, all that stuff would fall on Reed and Sue.
And then when
pressed into a corner, Sue could be so ridiculously overpowered that it makes up for the fact that she is not on the front line. But if you put her in a corner, she's going to fucking destroy you.
See, I feel Sue's the most powerful in a way. And she's, of all the, like, when everyone talks about, like, oh, the lack of female villains in the MCU, she is one of the two main Fox-owned characters that I would say is missing. Because she's on par, maybe like slightly below the Reed in intelligence, and her power level is almost
it's off the charts.
It's insane. Like, you can't even compare.
Like, I mean, the fact that she could manipulate something invisibly into your body and basically destroy your brain.
Yeah. No, Sue, I would treat Sue like the fucking big gun, because the Thing on the surface is the big gun, but if you need something to come in and just be wreck shop, like, Sue is the one you'd lean on.
Well, the whole thing is that the Fantastic Four is, you think that it's set up one way, but it's really another, because in anything, Reed is actually the tank.
Yeah.
Because he's virtually unkillable.
He can absorb a shitload of damage and just kind of keep going.
Yeah. Well, depending on your different thing, like, he doesn't need to breathe, he doesn't need to eat, he's really the Thing.
Yeah, he is. Well, and it's also ties back into what I think Trank was trying to do, which was originally he'd wanted to do body horror, which makes sense with the Fantastic Four.
Yeah,
but
he missed the whole family aspect, because you can't do that movie without filming two characters together ever.
Also, the issue with that is that the Venture Brothers did it already and did it far better than Frank.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That show's coming back in a month or two.
Yeah. Mm.
But yeah, with Fantastic Four, at least the way to handle them in the MCU, like Lou had mentioned in the future, I think pulling them out of time could work, but I think that would set up a lot of roadblocks for you further down the line. I feel like trying to do the whole, like, oh, strangers in a strange land type of thing coming out of a different time period, my whole thing would be that have them be a little bit more contemporary, have them be like a Captain Marvel, like they're doing with her.
Have them have already been here, they've been here long enough to adjust, so they're not like Cap, who's basically like, I don't know anything about this time period.
Well, exactly. I was going to say, like, have them have been scientists, whatever, in the 90s. Same idea. They all go into space, but then have, like, the Kree or whoever have taken them and performed genetic experiments on them, and then they were able to break free through some sort of means. Let's say Captain Marvel did something.
Okay. My view is very different. I would say either you have to go to kind of make them Spider-Man Homecoming contemporaries, where they're also high school kids in current time.
I,
kind of ultimate version,
I think. That's why it won't happen.
Yes, but I feel like if you're going to go modern interpretation, that's the the ultimate version is the best way. Otherwise, like we talked about, the kind of trapped in space, I would prefer the other way is to have them be this kind of similar to Captain America, this family that's lost in time, and they come back, and then they could kind of connect in a way to Cap and being like, and then Cap can kind of be hilariously the one that's like informing them of, like, catching them up to the modern...
I mean, that could be
but that's assuming that Cap is going to survive the next movie.
I mean, and a way to start it would be you see Reed in World War II fighting alongside Cap.
You see Reed with Hank Pym in that kind of timeline.
Oh, that's a way better idea.
Yeah,
in that kind of second-generation character. It's like Reed and Sue.
Yeah.
And then...
Well, Reed would he would be someone who was... in World War II. So him knowing a bunch of characters from that timeline, him meeting a young Pym, him like seeing Cap and being inspired by Cap in some way as a scientist.
Well, not even inspired by Cap, inspired by what's his name, the doctor that made him.
Yes, inspired by him in some way. That could be an interesting way to do things, I think.
At least not. They should make them goofier, kind of. Like, they should be, like, goofballs.
Yeah.
Cause, like,
I feel like Reed should be a very cheesy, pipe-smoking, dad joke kind of guy.
He's a character from the Venture Brothers.
Yeah,
yes.
And to suggest something other than what Lou is suggesting or Eric, another idea that just occurred to me is Just make them space characters. Make them, like, introduce them to yeah. Guardians. Like, at yeah. the end of Guardians 3, they find the Fantastic Four.
I don't mind that either way.
Yeah.
That could be that, you know, Reed was... I mean, because it's not that he gained his intelligence from the cosmic rays, but...
Who got the cosmic rays pushed him out?
Mm-hmm. Well, or even that he created some sort of portal and somehow, whatever means, all of them went through it. And yeah. once again, that would then introduce the cosmic rays aspect. But they would potentially be like modern people, but they just ended up in an alternate universe somehow, or whatever the case might be. Mm-hmm. So that would get rid of the having to contemporize them via other people telling them, like, no, this is what an iPhone is, and so on and so right. forth.
See, yeah. I think it would be interesting because either way, if you have them busting out of the negative zone, you can both introduce them and introduce the negative zone and Annihilus.
Yeah, yeah.
And then Annihilus is the eventuality of the space universe of MCU.
Yeah, I think that would be the best idea. But yeah, I think we can wrap it up, guys.
Yeah,
I think we've hit what we need to hit.
Everything fits together now.
Yeah.
Our continuity is solid.
All connected.
Yeah.
I don't really have, because this episode's coming in the future, I don't want to plug anything for certain because I'm not sure what's going to be going on the week this comes out with my other stuff. So I'm Connor and I've been here.
Oh, this is mid-June when this will be coming out. So yeah, but,
happy summer.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah. I can't wait for 120.
Yeah. Aharo and all the things, all the places. My calendar's being bad. Nope, now it's not. If things go as planned, Lost Haro podcast will have that Misfits episode out next week, and we should be finishing up De Palma. So look forward to that.
I'm at Easier on Twitter, and I am with Arlen on Lost Haro podcast. And if I'll give a recommendation of an episode that's for sure out, go back and listen to our Godzilla episode where Hunter was on, and it's really, really good.
Good episode. Also, get the fuck off my lawn.
There it is. We finally hit that point.
I'm Eric Fedorchek. You can find me at Eric_Fedor on Instagram, dogs, cats, comics, food. I'm also floating around the Phantom Zone. And I'd also like to know if Pennywise could take Benny Grimm's stone.
Don't you dare! We sell custom anti-Pennywise DVDs to help me. In the inevitable apocalypse.
When they bang against each other.
This is my life now. This is what happens every time.
Your anti-Pennywise suit that will protect you from interdimensional space beings.
Pennywise short, become the state of my evenings. Anyway, bye, everybody. Wait, who still has...
Lou.
Yeah, that's me. Smallville Chronicles. I think we're trying to come out every Wednesday. You should have listened to one of my favorite episodes of all time, Hourglass, which we get all the foreshadowing for the final episode of this final season. It's awesome, and this movie is not as bad as everybody said. Fuck you guys. It's clobbering time.
See, that should have been the point where you just turned off the mic and walked away, because I did that to them during the Marvel reviews about Doctor Strange.
But this is the future, so who said I didn't?
That's true.
Now I'm sitting here waiting to see if you will.
Bye!
Oh my god, I can't believe that's not the ending.
Bye, fuck everybody. This movie.
Fuck Gary Allen.